Bonjour, guten Tag, Strasvice, the guest fish stays noch immer aus zwei Beinen. Today's talk is a brief one focused on the Model 3. I was thinking of segmenting this into two groups. One group is new to EVs and the second group would be a Tesla group. So we'll see how it goes in terms of length. So there are a few things I'd like to cover on this vehicle. And in terms of it being, I want to say, somewhat challenged. So the first item I'd like to cover is what I call beta testing. What this is about is the fact that when you look at all the spy shots you've seen, it's always in really good California weather. There's no giant mountain there, etc. So what this means is that Tesla does, if you're Mercedes or one of the other big brands, or BMW or GM, what they'll do is take the finished product, send 10 or 20 copies into the Arctic, send 10 or 20 of the vehicles into a very hot climate, and then send it into just a regular environment to just see how the vehicle handles those different situations. And it gives you a chance to work out the bugs. What I'm fascinated by here is that there is no effort to strenuously put the vehicle through tests. So therefore, the real beta testing is going to be new owners for the first year. So I think that this is a challenging element of being a Tesla owner, because on one hand, you get to enjoy a car with the excellent battery distance that gives you the value of why you're getting the car. But beyond that, there isn't the quality of the rest of what goes on, I think, is a little shaky. And the first of those issues is the lack of beta testing. So a comparison would be, there's a vehicle I reviewed called the eCanter by Mercedes. They started working on the car, I believe, in 2006, or it's actually a truck product, but they switched over from diesel, starting with electric in the late, you know, like 2006, 2007, and they're now releasing it in 2017. So it gives you a feel for how long they've had to make sure this thing was right. The second item that I like to cover is, if you're new to the Tesla environment, one of the items that's brought up is the fact that you will now start getting, regardless of which car you get, you'll start getting updates that are downloaded periodically that provide new features, etc. Now, on the surface, when you look at this, what Elon Musk is saying, isn't it terrific? You get all these new features and they're added to your vehicle. As you dig a little deeper, one of the interesting ideas here is that you notice this isn't often done on other vehicles. If there are updates, you go to the dealer and the updates are done there. Why it's important to note this is that from talking with my software guys, what they pointed out to me was, you need to be aware that the reason why they're doing those updates is that they weren't ready before the car was sold, and this gives them opportunity to fix, you know, errors that were made or tests that weren't done on the fly. So there's a good news and bad news about the fact that you do get these updates. Another part of the bad news that was shared with me by a software executive PhD was, it's great that these software updates do occur and it seems like a competitive advantage, but one of the challenges with those updates is that they're using a encryption protocol, and the challenge with that is that it's a fairly secure protocol that allows Tesla to communicate with the vehicle, but the problem that pops up is that it's actually a situation where it can be hacked, or if bad people get a hold of that, it could end up being a disaster where your vehicle gets taken over, hacked, and then you don't know what it's going to do. So there is a little bit of a risk that goes with the so-called benefit of updates that Tesla might provide in this fashion. The third thing I wanted to cover is the fact that, let's look at the Autopilot 2 technology. Last year, Elon Musk announced let's say in late spring, that there were plans to put an Autopilot 2 together, both hardware and software, and that this new Autopilot 2 was better than what Mobileye was doing out of the box, or the technology was better already. Well, what happened was Tesla began overlaying changes to the Mobileye software to add more autonomous features, and perhaps one of the worst consequences of this was that there was a Tesla owner who was killed because he was relying on those autopilot features in error and kind of get caught and killed in the process. So I bring this up again now because we all know about it, both you know, owners and non-owners. And what I found interesting is that after talking with my software folks, what they explained is the Mobileye product, even though it's a little bit old still, for those who are in Model X's and S's already, because Mobileye, up until Tesla left, had 90% of the car companies in the world using their product, it allowed their system to keep learning and developing both features inherent to each car company, as well as learning mapping, etc. So one of the benefits that owners were getting was the fact that you have all this data being rolled up into the Mobileye system and shared with all the cars and manufacturers. And so therefore, every owner was getting the benefit of that knowledge that was being provided by all those data points. As we speak now, 4 days before the Model 3 is released, maybe 3 or 4 weeks ago, I spoke with a new Model X owner, and he said the autopilot was buggy and was not ready, and there will be further updates. Hopefully by July, when the car is introduced, probably no non-Tesla employees will see a Model 3 until, you know, October or November. But the problem is, number one, software wasn't ready, and number two, there's a second challenge here, which is how much data are you getting from, let's say, the 100,000 Tesla vehicles on the road around the world by October or November versus, you know, the 10 million Mobileye vehicles that are on the road. So I think that the issue that we're facing here is that it's being installed in the vehicles, both Model X's and S's. It's a little buggy and not ready yet. It's getting better every 8 to 10 weeks, and it'll continue to get better, but I think it's really in a beta test mode, and therefore I think we'll really see its best possibility by the middle of next year, because you'll have thousands and thousands of cars all over the place picking up data that they add to the learning that the vehicle will do. And so I really think we'll see the best of what Autopilot can do relative to Autopilot 2 can do relative to Autopilot 1 by the middle of next year. The final thing I wanted to cover that you can generally confirm here is, I want to say Elon Musk has a little bit of Steve Jobs in him, in that Steve Jobs made a famous comment where you walk into a Nike store, you look around what they have there, and it's a great company with great products, but you really need to take away 20% of the crap they're selling and just get rid of it to have a more clean environment. So one of the examples of sort of a clean environment that comes to mind is that Tesla recently made a change on the seat backs of all their vehicles. It used to be a very shiny plastic finish. This resulted in kids and rear passengers putting footmarks on that glossy surface. And so Elon finally relented and decided to allow them to do a finish that would be more responsive to cleanse and dirt. So it's not a shiny surface anymore. It's kind of a dull finish, which I think is good. I'm hoping that when the employees see this video, they consider allowing rear seat passengers to maybe not have the in-seat video capability, but at least have the facilities for it, be it a plug-in, etc., so that consumers with kids or rear passengers can have a way to provide entertainment to kids or other groups that might be rear seat passengers. I think there are other things that Tesla could do to facilitate what I want to say creature comforts within the vehicle, but their strategy has been to have a very clean, non-cluttered environment, but it really results in people with needs other than what are covered by the car company having a hard time finding a way to sort of create an environment that that's enjoyable. So I thought I'd post this and review a few sort of issues that I thought lurked, that lurked within the whole Model 3 environment that were legitimate things to be covered as we go into delivery of the vehicle. I'll be eager to see what your feedback is. There are a few other things I might cover, like, you know, depending on the environment you live in, how wide a tire should you put on the car, very narrow or very wide. You know, there are a few different items one could cover in order to optimize the experience with the Model 3. Thanks for watching. Tschüss, mach's gut. Au revoir. Lahitraot. Choda hafez. Salam alaikum. Guten Dank. And thank you to my friends in the Netherlands for dropping me a note. And please drop me a note from other parts of the world as you view this video. Please like again and subscribe. Helps us to do jobs better. Patreon assistance would be greatly appreciated. I'm going to again take you out with a view of the area here. We're in Alexandria, Virginia. And you'll notice the Woodrow Wilson Bridge.